Die Dopamin-Nation. Frau Dr. Anne Lemke ist heute mein Gast. Im ersten Teil haben wir schon gesprochen, was Dopamin alles in unser aller Körper bewirkt, wofür wir es brauchen und wann es uns auch schadet. Und jetzt im zweiten Teil wird es darum gehen, welche Praxistipps wir da mitnehmen können, um im Alltag uns selber, unseren Kindern und denen, die uns umgeben, Gutes zu tun, gut mit Dopamin klarzukommen. Professor Anne Lemke, it's a great pleasure and honor having you.
Thank you. I'm excited to be here. It's been nice talking with you.
In our first part, we were talking about what dopamine is, how it kind of harms us when we have too much of it and due to gaming and other drugs, of our drug of choice. And then the second part, I would like to focus on how we can gain a state of How would you call it? Balance?
Yeah. So I think, you know, the idea is that right now we're walking around with our pleasure pain balance tilted chronically to the side.
this is maybe the worst, because everybody always has his or her smartphones with him
and
everything seems to be so important. Bling bling all the time. Yeah.
Right. Right. So I think without even realizing it, we're constantly stimulating our reward pathway, and our brains have compensated by putting us into this dopamine deficit state, which makes us anxious and depressed and just generally unhappy. So the very first, you know, intervention is to actually abstain from our drug of choice, whether it's sugar or whether it's romance novels, as in my case, or whether it's cannabis or alcohol or nicotine or opioids or video games or pornography, to abstain for long enough for those neuroadaptation gremlins to hop off the pain side of the balance and for the level balance to be restored. And why is that so important? Because it's only once we've reset our dopamine threshold to a healthy level, that is, we have a level balance, that we can then, number one, take joy in more modest rewards. So our lens opens and we can enjoy seeing a friend and having a conversation. We can enjoy reading a book that's not, you know, too overly stimulating. We can enjoy going on a walk or watching a sunset. But the other really important reason for this dopamine fast is because when we're chasing dopamine, it's very difficult to see true cause and effect. That is to say, it's hard for us to really see that our drug is making us unhappy. But when we stop for a while and we reset our reward pathways, we're able to really look back and say, oh, wow, that using that substance or doing that behavior made me unhappy. It's not something that we can see in the moment.
How would we find out what this is?
You mean, how do we find out which drug we need to give up?
Yeah.
Well, for many of us, it's obvious. I mean, we all know that thing that we use too much of, that we overdo it, that we regret afterwards, that once we start, we have difficulty stopping, right? And I think today with digital devices, we're all struggling with that, putting our phone down, right? We're watching a Netflix, you know, show, and we promised we would just watch one episode and we find ourselves clicking for another episode. We're on YouTube and 2 hours later, we're still on YouTube or TikTok or whatever it is. So it's those types of behaviors where we are being controlled by the behavior rather than really controlling the behavior. Those are probably our addictive areas. And that's the drug that we need to give up for a period of time.
So if we do such a dopamine fast, as you call it, if we give up one thing, can we then, or shall we switch to something else? So that we, because maybe if you stop drinking wine, or if you stop taking the TikTok video, watching the TikTok video, and then you switch to drinking wine or whatever. So another just switching the drug, is there any sense by that, in that, or? Or, would, or does dopamine fasting mean completely stopping everything? That's good for you. That's feeling good.
That feels good. Yeah. So, I mean, you can do like a minor dopamine fast where you just give up, you know, a certain type of video game, or you just say, I'm not going to be on Twitter for a period of time, or you just say, I'm not going to eat donuts or whatever it is. Or you can decide to do a more expansive fast where you eliminate all of those reinforcing substances and behaviors. Usually when I'm working with patients, I have them choose just one, the one thing that's really problematic. I don't have them eliminate all pleasures, but I do warn them about cross addiction. So cross addiction is real. And this is this idea that if you try to give up one thing, but you replace it with another thing, it's you're very likely to get addicted.
So stop gaming, start drinking. It's not good.
No, that's not good.
No.
And, but that's very common advice that people say, well, replace one rewarding behavior with another rewarding behavior. And that doesn't really work. And in fact, what I'm advocating for is not reaching for a substance or behavior, but rather learning to tolerate the discomfort that comes with simply sitting with those emotions, which I think is something that we don't do, because there are so many ways now that we can distract ourselves.
What about what Wim Hof recommends? He said do the breathing exercises if you have the urge to whatever, or do take the cold shower if you have an urge.
Yeah, so that's exactly right. And again, if you think of this balance, remember when we pressed on the pleasure side, those gremlins hop on the pain side in order to eventually try to restore.
It just freezes them.
Yeah. Well, no, what I was going to say is that the gremlins actually don't care what the initial stimulus is. So if the initial stimulus is pleasure, they will hop on pain. But if the initial stimulus is pain, so if we intentionally do something that's painful, like take an ice cold water, those gremlins will hop on the pleasure side in order to bring us level again. And this is the science of hormesis. Hormesis is Greek for to set in motion. And what happens when we intentionally do things that are hard, like exercise, ice cold water, or even psychological tasks that are challenging, or cognitive tasks
for example,
that are challenging. Meditation requires a certain amount of concentration, doing something that's intellectually challenging, or committing to tell the truth, or apologizing. All of those things are hard. They press on the pain side of the balance, but the gremlins hop on the pleasure side, and eventually we reset our set point to the side of pleasure. So that's the key, that by doing things that are hard up front, we pay for our dopamine up front. And the result is that we trigger our body's own healing mechanism to start to upregulate production of dopamine, serotonin, norepinephrine, and other feel-good hormones and neurotransmitters.
So do you have, you also said you have maybe a slide or something for that?
Yeah.
And the second question, when you talk about dopamine, is it also kind of a metaphor for all the other happy hormones, because I always read about serotonin as well, or what is the connection with that?
So, you know, obviously the pleasure pain balance and talking just about dopamine is an oversimplification.
Yeah.
You know, serotonin is very important too. Serotonin gives this feeling of expansiveness or connection, and it's also a feel-good hormone. But again, dopamine is sort of the final common currency for all of these other modulators.
And the pain thing, is that then correlated with endorphins?
Right. So exactly. So for example, when we press on the pain side, what we're doing is, again, we're triggering our own endogenous feel-good chemicals, including our own endogenous opioids or endorphins. Endorphins are our own opioids, mm-hmm. as well as serotonin, norepinephrine, dopamine. It's triggering that whole kind of cocktail of substances. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So here is kind of an acronym for what to do about this problem. It all pivots around abstinence and this abstinence or this dopamine fast. I recommend fasting for 30 days. Why? Because 30 days is usually the amount of time it takes for the gremlins to hop off the pain side of the balance and for homeostasis to be restored. In preparation for the dopamine fast, these are the things that we can do. Data is where we basically just write down or tell another human being, what is our drug of choice? What are we using? How much are we using? How often are we using? When we do this, our behavior sort of comes into relief. In other words, we see it in a way that's very hard to see when we're not talking about it. A lot of times patients will come into my office and I'll say, well, how much pot are you smoking? You know, and we'll go back through the last week. And when they tell me, they often then have a reaction to that, like, wow, I hadn't realized it was that much. So there's something that happens when we put it into words. Objectives is where we talk about, why do I use this drug? What does it do for me? What is the good part about it? What's important to realize, though, is that the initial reason that we start using a drug, which is usually either to have fun or to solve a problem, the initial reason eventually isn't necessarily the reason that we keep using the drug. And because the reason that we keep using down the road is often because we're trying to restore homeostasis. It's the physiologic drive, which is really
because we are afraid it might change. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Right. Well, it's just so powerful. I mean, when we're in a dopamine deficit state, the urge to use is overwhelming. And then the P has to do with our kind of acknowledging, well, what are the problems with my use? Well, I'm not spending any time on my hobbies, or I'm not getting enough sleep, or my health is compromised, or I'm not really present for my family in the way that I want to be present. And that was certainly what I discovered with romance novels. Every available moment, I was just escaping into fantasy, and I wasn't present for my family, my husband, and my children in the way that I really wanted to be present for them. So all of that then leads up to the dopamine fast, where we set a specific quit date, we let people know. If we're talking about getting off of a digital drug, then we want to make sure that people that we interact with on that social media outlet or whatever it is, they know that we're going to be unavailable for a while. And then what immediately happens as soon as we stop using our drug is that we feel really bad because, you know, we take the weight off of the pleasure side and we've already got these gremlins living on the pain side with their barbecue, right? And so we crash down and we feel anxious, depressed, we can't sleep. We're constantly thinking about using. With digital drugs, it's the constant fear of missing out or FOMO. And this really is a wonderful opportunity to practice mindfulness. So we talk a lot about mindfulness, but really what is mindfulness? Mindfulness is observing our thoughts and feelings without reacting to them and without judging them. What usually happens when we're experiencing some kind of discomfort is that we don't want to practice mindfulness. We want to just get rid of it. But this dopamine fast or this abstinence trial forces us to just sort of mindfully observe those thoughts and feelings. And many times we achieve a kind of an aha moment or an insight where, number one, we learn about ourselves, but also we realize the extent to which we had been using our drug to escape from ourselves. And this is really important, which is why we need this distance from our drug. Then the N stands for next step. So if we're able to fast from our drug of choice for a month or whatever the time frame is, and we feel better and we decide that we want to go back to using our drug or with our digital devices, we have to go back for work or whatever it is, then we need to think about what can we do to help ourselves limit our use so that we can remain in balance, right? Once the gremlins hop off and we've restored a level balance, how do we stay there? We need a supple level balance. We don't want those gremlins to accumulate on the pain side. So we have to make sure that we use in modest amounts, that we leave enough time in between for the gremlins to hop off. And to do that, we need to create a world within a world. What do I mean by that? I mean that this world that we live in is constantly titillating us, constantly inviting us to consume, constantly compelling us to get addicted. Once we are offered our drug, it's very hard to say no. So we have to build barriers or self-binding strategies between ourselves and our drug of choice so that we're not constantly being tempted. And this gets back to something else that I didn't show you, which is here. So this is an experiment that's been done in rats that if the rat presses the button, they get an injection of cocaine, right? And when they get an injection of cocaine, dopamine firing goes way up. So dopamine levels are represented by this vertical line. But this is very interesting here. The rat is trained to know that when it sees a light, that if it then goes and presses this button, it will get cocaine. So what happens once the rat has learned that? When it sees the light, just seeing the light increases dopamine levels above baseline, right? So just the light itself is a reward. But look what happens right after the light. The dopamine doesn't just go down to baseline levels. It goes actually below baseline levels. So just seeing the light trips or begins the state of craving, right? The dopamine deficit state. And then that motivates the animal to do whatever is necessary to go and do the work, to press the button, to bring it up above again. So this is really, really important because all of these alerts and things that we're getting on our phones that remind us of our drug actually go through the little cycle of using the drug itself, right? A little primer, a little dopamine hit, a little dopamine deficit state, and then we're in craving. And once we're in craving, it's very hard to resist. So we have to build barriers so that we don't even expose ourselves to that initial stimulus.
But that's not always possible.
No, it's not always possible. But people don't even realize.
Especially when it comes to certain foods or to nicotine or alcohol, it's just every day, all the time around you.
Yes, but what you can do in your own home, for example, is not have the nicotine products in your home.
Oh, of course, yeah.
But these are things that people don't necessarily think of, right? Don't keep the potato chips in your home. In early recovery, don't go to a party where you know people are going to be using your drug. Maybe later down when your recovery is stronger, you can do that, but don't tempt yourself in that way initially because physiologically, once you are triggered, it's going to be really hard to. So in other words, the use or the relapse, the trigger for that comes much earlier than the moment when you're offered the drug. And so we have to build these barriers so that we're not constantly being invited or titillated to use. And then once we set up a very specific plan for how we're going to reintegrate our drug or how we're not going to use our drug if we're going to continue to abstain, then we go out and we do the experiment, right? And we test and see if that works. And if it we gather the data, and if it doesn't work, then we try again.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You said escaping from ourselves. That really stuck to me. Yeah, very interesting. Very interesting.